فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So let's go back to, inshallah ta'ala, let's go back to the sabab al-ta'an al-rawi, the criticism that is put onto the narrator in terms of his memory. Five. How many is it? Five. The first one is fuhshul ghalat. Fuhshul ghalat. Fuhshul ghalat means he does many mistakes. Fuhshul ghalat is when the narrator, he makes many, many mistakes. And that hadith is called Munkar. The one who has Fuhshul Ghalat, his hadith is called Munkar. How would the scholars reach the conclusion that this person has Fuhshul Ghalat? Fuhshul Ghalat means, the word Fuhsh means a lot. Ghalat means mistakes. He's got too many mistakes. How would the scholars reach a conclusion that this person has too much mistakes? Is when they look at his narrations, let's say he narrated 10 hadiths. If 8 of those hadiths are wrong and 2 of them are right, he's got Fuhshul Ghalat. So it's all compared to how many narrations he's mentioned. But if he gets 8 hadith wrong, and he's narrated 80 hadith, then this is not Fuhshul Ghalat. Does that make sense? It's not the number, it's in the
quantity.
It's a percentage of his narrations. Because there's not an individual on the face of this earth who doesn't fall into mistakes. No one. Then the author mentioned from those whose narrations are the criticism of a narrator, su'ul hifdh. He has bad memory. His memorization is excessively bad. Su'ul hifdh. And su'ul hifdh is two types. First of all, what does it mean? It's that his mistakes pass what he gets right, or it's equal. Some of you might think to yourself, what's the difference between that and fuhshul ghalat, right? We'll come to it. Su'ul hifd is two types. Su'ul hifd lazimun lirrawi. This narrator is excessive. This is a characteristic of his. He's always doing mistakes. So his memorization, sorry. Su'ul hifd is bad memorization. And so this is a characteristic that stuck with him. This person's hadith becomes shad, according to a view that stands. The second one is that, no, his memory was good. He was a sharp person. But he became like this. This is now called mukhtalit. He mixed up now. Ikhtilat happened to him. He used to have good memory. He was a sharp person. But now suddenly, his memory has now become bad. This is called ikhtilat. It's called ikhtilat. It's called what? Al-ikhtilat. The third one is ghafla, heedlessness. The third one is ghafla, heedlessness. And what it means is that yashu ya'tari al-insan fayaghib anhu muraduhu wa la yatadhakkar. Heedlessness, he's absent-minded. If somebody gives him a narration, says, this is your, one of your hadiths that you narrated to me, he'll say, okay. He accepts talqeen. He should be sharp, realize, no, it's not my narration, what are you doing? It's not my narration, I never told you this. Like when Yahya ibn Ma'in tried to test Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn. And Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn didn't accept it from him. Every time he put a narration in just to see his memory, And he did it deliberately. Abu Nu'aym became upset and kicked Yahya ibn Mu'in in the chest from the stool that he was sitting on. Because Yahya ibn Abu Nu'aym, Fadl ibn Dukayn, was alert and he had no ghafla. And Yahya tumbled backwards from the stool that he was sitting on. And Ahmed said, I told you, wallahi, you wouldn't listen to me. All day I was telling you, leave this man alone. This man is known. His precision, his memory is something else. And he said, I enjoy his kick. I enjoyed the kick that he kicked me. It was worth the journey, even better than the journey that I went through when I went to Abdul Razzaq ibn Hamam al-Sanani. I preferred that kick. Now I know when I speak about Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, and somebody asks me about him, I can surely tell them that he's an hafidh mutqin. And that's how he was. So ghafla is a narration that's weakened. Then the next one is kathratul awham. Kathratul awham is basically excessive mistakes. Excessive mistakes. This one, kathratul awham, is two types. Understand this, it's two types. The first type is zahir, apparent. Are you with me? And two fall under that, which you just took. Fuhshul ghalat and ghafla. Ghafla is a form of wahm, but it's the zahir, the apparent form. Are you with me, brothers? So now you guys know why Ibn Hajar brought this. Wahm. I remember some people asked in the Sharh of Bayquniya, what's the difference? It's the difference. The wahm, that's zahir, it encompasses what? Fuhshul ghalat and ghafla, they fall under it. Are you with me, brothers? But the second type of wahm, which is khafi, hidden, that's the one the scholars call mu'allal. The hadith that's called a defect. The defect narration. Where you see Bukhari and Ahmed and other scholars say what? This hadith is what? Mu'allal. Somebody's done a wahm. Are you with me, brothers? There's no fuhshu ghalat. There's no ghafla. It's not that apparent. Here it's khafi. And how he's going to say it, how he's going to realize it, is bil qara'in wa jam'u turuq, bringing the narrations together, bringing it all together and reaching a conclusion and say, you know what, this is what it is. That's the form that scholars refer to as mu'allal. This hadith is defected. Does that make sense, brothers? So kathratul awham here doesn't mean the zahir version, because the zahir already took the two out of it. Did he take it out? He took it out. Ghafla and fuhshul ghalat are wahm, but they are the most apparent type of wahm. The one he means here when he says kathratul awham, he means wahm which is khafi. And last but not least is mukhalafatu thiqat. The opposition of the reliable people. And five Ibn Hajar mentions that come under it. Five. Are you with me? Five fall under the mukhalafatul thiqah that the author mentions. Are you with me, brothers? The first one is al-mudraj. And the mudraj is two types. The mudraj is what? Two types. Mudrajul Isnad and Mudrajul Matni. Are you with me? All of these five are mukhalafat. Mukhalafat al-thiqat means opposition of reliable people. It's also criticized, it's also weakened. Mukhalafa means what? Are you with me, brothers? Pay attention here. It's opposition of the trustworthy integrity, those who hold high integrity and reliability, opposition. Does that make sense, brothers? And it happens in five ways. Mudraj is the first one. Mudraj is, has how many types? Two types. Mudrajul Isnad, which is? It's asserting, it's to assert or change the chain of narration. It's to change the narration. We call that Mudrajul Isnad. The second one is called Mudrajul Matni. Mudrajul Matni means what? A speech of the person enters the narration. For example, it happens very common with Zuhri. Are you with me? Is that then, I'm talking sometimes, and it happens even to me a lot of the times. And that is, brothers are typing something I'm saying. So I'm an example, I might read the kalam of Ibn al-Qayyim. Now I'm AbdulRahman, I always explain what the kalam is. Are you with me? So what happens is, they think my explanation is actually the statement of Ibn al-Qayyim. So still adding it to Ibn al-Qayyim's statement. And that's not Ibn al-Qayyim said. Does that make sense? So they add my speech into the speech of Ibn al-Qayyim. And a lot of the time, that happens when this person is trying to comment on something, where the student can't tell between when is he talking and when is he quoting. So it's better always to just quote, say end of quote, and explain it. That is very common with who? Zuhri. He does that a lot. That's called mudraj. Huh? Then the second one is maqloob. Maqloob is when a hadith goes back to front. It's taqdeem and ta'khir. It's a very, very common hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, which Abu Hurairah narrated that the Prophet ﷺ said, سَبْعَةٌ يَضِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. Seven, Allah is going to give them a shade the day of judgment when there is no shade. And from them is what? رَجُلٌ أَنْفَقَ بِيَمِينِهِ. The narration says, رَجُلٌ أَنْفَقَ بِشِمَالِهِ فَأَخْفَاهَا حَتَّى لَا تَعْلَمُ يَمِينُهُ مَا أَنْفَقَتِهِ. The narration went back to front. That a person gave with their left, and they hid it so much that their right doesn't know what their left gave. It's meant to be what? They gave with their right, that their left doesn't know what the right gave. But in Bukhari, maqloob happened. It just turned. This is another form of opposition of another narration. And that's why Ibn al-Qayyim as well, when it came to the hadith of placing your knees down on the ground first, or your hands down, Ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab Zad al-Ma'ad fi Hadi Khayr al-Ibad, what did he say? He says that this narration that says put your hands down first, he said it's maqloob. That narration that says put your hands down first on the ground, he said this narration is maqloob. And that it should be put your knees down first. And that's not a correct opinion. We hold strongly that you have to place your hands down first before you place your knees down first. وَذَا مَسْأَلَ فِقْهِيَةً. It is, but did the hadith, is it authentically transmitted from the Prophet ﷺ? لَا يَبْرُكْ أَحَدُكُمْ كَمَا يَرْبُرُكُ الْبَعِيرُ وَلْيَضَعْ يَدَاهُ قَبْلَ الرُّكْبَتَاءِ. Is it sahih from the Prophet? نعم, صحت. It's sahih, سَنَدًا وَمَتْنًا. That you put your hands down first. That narration is authentic, سَنَدًا وَمَتْنًا. The third one is called, sorry, did I finish it? Yeah. The third one I need. I finished maqloob, right? The third one is called al-mazidu fi muttasil al-asanid. The person, he adds a narrator into the chain of narration, extra narrator. And the fourth one is مُضَّرِب. The مُضَّرِب is contradiction. This opposition is coming because of what? As Ibn Hajar mentions, إِبْدَالُ رَاوِن is changing a narrator with another narrator. And what? وَلَا مُرَجِّحَ. There's no way to do tarjih. This is called مُضَّرِب. This hadith got اضْضِرَاب. It's contradicting. It can also happen to the matan. It can. And that's the hadith, what? كُلُّ أَمْرٍ ذِي بَالٍ لَا يُبْدَأْ فِيهِ بِبِسْمِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ أَبْتَرُ فَهُوَ أَقْطَعُ فَهُوَ الْأَجْدَمُ. All those words are مُضَّرِب. There's اضْضَرَاب, contradicting. All the meanings are contradicting one another. So even if we forget about the sanad, the matan itself, each wording, what it's saying, is contradicting the other wording. مُضَّرِب. Scholars rejected the hadith. Last but not least is the issue of musahhaf. What's the difference between musahhaf and muharraf? Musahhaf means when the letters, it's distortion by the way. Musahhaf means distortion. Musahhaf is when the letters get affected. And muharraf is when the dots get affected. One is the shakal, one is the nuqat. Ibn Hajar mentions it. Al-musahhafu wal-muharrafu. We have now finished a hadith which are mardood. And not to be, and to be honest, we finished all of the chapter which is taqseem al-hadith bi'atibari wusulihi ilayna. That whole chapter of dividing the hadith and categorizing the hadith in terms of how it reached us, we finished it. How many types did I say the khabar is divided into? Two. In terms of how it reached us, and the second one was what? In terms of it, in terms of who it's attributed to. Ibn Hajar now is going to go into, in terms of who it's, going back to the one. Once we finished in terms of who it's attributed to, Mustalahul Hadith is over, it's finished. From this minute onwards, after we speak about in terms of who it's attributed to, everything after that has nothing to do with tasheeh and tadrif. Authenticating and strengthening hadith. It's now jarh al-ta'deel. When the scholars say this, what do they mean? Sah? How do you take narrations? How are narrations passed on? Are you with me, brothers? If it's your choice. If you guys want to still finish it off and study that, we could. If you want to stop there and say, khalas, intaha al-amr, we studied mustalah al-hadith, the science itself that we needed. Weakening and authenticating, we could. So let's just take this one now, inshallah.
قال رحمه الله تعالى ثم الإسناد إما أن ينتهي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تصريحا أو حكما من قوله أو فعله أو تقريره أو إلى الصحابي كذلك وهو من لقي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مؤمنا به ومات عن الإسلام ولو تخللت ردة في الأصح أو إلى التابعي وهو من لقي الصحابي كذلك فالأول المرفوع والثاني الموقوف والثالث المقطوع ومن دون التابعي فيه مثله ويقال للآخر للأخيرين الأثر والمسند مرفوع صحابي بسند ظاهره الاتصال.
The author رحمه الله now goes into categorizing hadith in terms of who it's attributed to. He mentioned three, but he's left a fourth one. Does anyone know what he left? Hadith al-Qudsi. The reason why he didn't mention that? Huh? Does anyone know? Homework. Homework. Sah? Tomorrow. But he didn't mention Hadith al-Qudsi. Sah? So this is something you can add on to it. So the first one is al-Hadith al-Marfu'. Hadith al-Marfu' is that which is attributed to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly or by ruling. What does he mean directly? Tasrihan or hukman?
Speech of the Prophet ﷺ. Or the, something that attributes him without his speech. Or his
speech the meaning.
I mean, يعني, hukman is it has the ruling of Umar for. It's as if the Prophet ﷺ said it, but he didn't actually say the Prophet ﷺ said it.
Beautiful. Tasrih means ما أضيف للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من قول أو فعل أو تقرير أو صفة خلقية أو خلقية. It's anything that's attributed to the Prophet in terms of his speech, actions. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's consents, the consent, what he consented to, his attitude and how he carried himself and his manners, and also how Allah created him. All of that is hadith. That's direct. Hukman means when a sahabi talks about an event that's going to happen the day of judgment, and nowhere can he have ever got that from except the Prophet. The scholars, they call this موقوف لفظا مرفوع حكما. Its wording is موقوف, meaning it stops at a companion, but the ruling is a ruling of مرفوع. He's talking about Jannah and Nar and how the people are going to do. How does he know that? Where would he get that from? بشرط. بشرط. If that Sahabi is not known to take from Bani Israel. Like for example, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, la. His narrations are not meant said موقوف لفظا مرفوع حكما. It's a khas. He's specific. The reason is because Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, he went to the Jews on the day of Khaybar, I think it was Khaybar. And he went and he took two big zawiyatayni, two big baskets from the Yahud, and in there was their book and their works. And he wanted it, he took it, and he used to read them. So sometimes he would narrate from Banu Israel. So scholars say that he's direct, can take, be taking it from there. When he says it, he's not taking it from the Prophet, he's taking it from here. So there's a takhsis of him. Are you with me? But as for the other companions, when they say it, they never read the kutubs and the akhwal of Banu Israel. So who are they he heard this from? The Prophet alayhi sallam. So they say it's mawqufu lafzan. The wording is mawquf because this sahabi didn't attribute it to the Prophet. But marfu' hukman, it's marfu' in terms of its hukum. That's called marfu'. Then the second one is called mawquf. Mawquf means what? What's attributed to a companion. It's called what? Mawquf. What's attributed, the third one is what? What's attributed to tabi'i? What's it called? Maqtu'. Maqtu' is called what? A tabi'i. Whatever is attributed to tabi'i is called maqtu'. Also, Ibn Hajar took the opinion that even anybody after a tabi'i is also called maqtu'. He says, وَمَنْ دُونَ التَّابِعِي فِيهِ مِثْلُهُ. Same. Anything after a tabi'i, it's called maqtu'. And then he goes on to say in, وَيُقَالُ لِلْآخَرَيْنِ, the last two, which is mawquf and maqtu', are called athar. Anything that's attributed to the companions, and anything that's attributed to what? The tabi'in is called a what? Athar. Somebody asks, what's athar? What does it mean? That which is attributed to them. Other scholars, they say, la, athar is a synonym of a khabar. So it encompasses the Prophet ﷺ, right? That's what some said. And the fourth one which he left out, which is what? Al-hadithu al-qudsiyu. Hadithu al-qudsi is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. So that's the order it should be. Hadithu al-qudsi is number one, then hadith which is marfu', and then a hadith which is mawquf, and then a hadith which is maqtu'. Now those are the four a hadith can be attributed to, صح? Those are the four in terms of who a hadith can be attributed to. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah to explain to you, he said to you, the Sahabi's definition is man laqiya an-nabiyya, it's anyone who met the Prophet. He didn't say look. He didn't say anyone who saw the Prophet because some companions were blind. Ah, you can't say it's somebody who saw the Prophet. This is wrong. You can't say that. You have to say somebody who met the Prophet. Met. When he met the Prophet ﷺ, he met him in what state? مُؤْمِنًا بِهِ, in a state of Iman. وَمَاتَ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ, and he died upon Islam. وَلَوْ تَخَلَّلَتْ رِدَّتُهُ فِي الْأَصْحَابِ, even if there was a time he disbelieved. If he did believe, disbelieve in a period of time, but he came back to Islam before he died, he's a companion. No one's going to dispute him. If he comes back to Islam, أَتَّائِبُ مِنَ الذَّنْبِ كَمَنْ لَا ذَنْبَ لَهُ. An example for that is Al-Ash'at ibn Qais. Ash'ath ibn Qais radda wa raja'a. Ash'ath ibn Qais was a companion, he left Islam, he came back again. Not two people disputed him, that he's still a companion. Does that make sense? Where did this come from? It goes back to the concept of when a person apostates, does his deeds nullify or does it wait for him to die? Sah? This is a mas'ala, it goes back to mas'ala usul. And that's inshallah we're going to deal with it. It's adilla and it's aqwal from there. Which is the issue of when a person apostates, does his deeds all go? Like for example, somebody done Hajj. Wartadda. Waraja'a ila Islam. Do you say, okay, Hajj again? He left Islam. Or does his Hajj that he did when he was a Muslim still stand? Mas'al fiqhiyya. Sah? That's its place. Who? Ash'at ibn Qais. He was a companion. He saw the Prophet.
Second time.
So he came back, well, the Prophet's dead. The Prophet was dead, alayhi sallam. It was after the Prophet sallam, he apostated. So that's the Shaykh he took. That's why he said, وَلَوْ تَخَلَّلَتْ رِدَّةٌ فِي الْأَصَحِّ. He said, according to the strongest opinion. Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentioned the issue of what's a musnad. Are you with me, brothers? Some scholars, they took the opinion that musnad is any hadith that's connected. Ibn Hajar is of the opinion, no. It's connected and it's marfu'. The raf' is differed upon. Some say, la, it's not marfu', it doesn't have to be marfu'. A mawquf is also musnad. A maqtu' can also be a musnad, as long as it's as long as it's connected to the sahabi. As long as he says, wal musnadu marfu' sahabi bi sanadin zahiru al-ittisal. Are you with me? And he's refuting a people who see opposite to what he says. We've now finished al-khabar wa taqsimatuhu, khabar and its categorization. This point, we've taken sahih and da'if. What we're now going to enter is something that this chapter is gone. Before I move on, are you brothers, you guys ready to go in? Should we go in, carry on? So we can say we finished Nukhbatul Fikr. Some of you guys know, please, let's go home. We've got time, we've got 2 hours left. It goes under categorizing khabar in terms of who it's ascribed to.
And that one goes under.
So it's we categorize the khabar into two. We categorize the khabar into two. The khabar in terms of how it reached us, and the second was in terms of who it's ascribed to. That's where it goes. It's the first categorization that we did. Brothers, can we take the questions right at the end? Write it down, please. Sisters can benefit from your questions. Sisters will benefit from those questions that you guys put. Write it, take a little paper. Because sometimes a question might come to your mind. Write it down, and we'll respond to it, inshallah ta'ala, if we have the knowledge for it. Okay? To repeat the definition of the musnad. Of course I can repeat that, inshallah. The musnad is marfu' sahabiyyin bisanadin zahiru al-ittisal. It's a hadith that's connected. It's a hadith which is connected to the Prophet. That's what he believes. Whereas others have said, no, it's connected is the only condition. It doesn't have to be connected to the Prophet. It can be connected to sahabi. It can be connected to tabi'i. It can be connected to tabi'i. It doesn't matter. Ibn Hajar is saying, no. I want it to reach the Prophet. The connection has to be right to the Prophet. Does that make sense? So for him, it's what? It's a hadith that's connected to the Prophet ﷺ. There's more details pertaining to that. We'll leave it there, inshallah ta'ala. Now let's go in, inshallah ta'ala, with the other chapters that the author brought.
قال رحمه الله تعالى فإن قل عدده فإما أن ينتهي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أو إلى إمام ذي صفة عالية كشعبة فالأول العلو المطلق والثاني النسبي وفيه الموافقة وهي الوصول إلى شيخ أحد المصنفين من غير طريقه وفيه البدل وهو الوصول إلى شيخ شيخه كذلك وفيه المساواة وهي استواء عدد الإسناد من الراوي إلى آخره مع إسناد أحد المصنفين وفيه المصافحة وهي الاستواء مع تلميذ ذلك المصنف ويقابل العلو بأقسامه النزول.
The author رحمه الله تعالى, he now goes into a concept known as سلسلة الرواة. He's now going back to the issue of the chain, the concept of chain, and matters pertaining to it. The author, rahimahullah, he mentions that the scholars, when they look at the chain of narration, they categorize it in terms of its length and how long and how short it is. They categorize it into two. The first one is a hadith which is, that has what? Ulu. And a hadith which has nuzul. This has nothing to do with authenticity and weakness. A ulu can be weak, and a nazil can be sahih. A nazil can be weak, and a ulu can be authentic. There's nothing really to do with authenticity and weakening a narration here. It's just something that the scholars used to love, and that is getting close to the messenger. Ulu means between you and the Prophet there's a very short chain of narration. Are you with me? Today, if I'm not wrong, if I'm not wrong. The shortest chain of hadith books today is with the noble Sheikh, Sheikh Zahiruddin al-Mubarakafuri, صح? He has the shortest chains of hadith books today. He's in India. Sheikh Zahiruddin al-Mubarakafuri. So if I now go to Sheikh Zahiruddin al-Mubarakafuri and I narrate Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i from him and he gives it to me, I will be leveled with Hafiz al-Hakami. Hafiz al-Hakami and me, I will be leveled. Are you with me, brothers? I will be leveled with Abdullah al-Qara'awi, above Hafiz al-Hakami. The teacher of Hafiz al-Hakami. The one who commanded Hafiz al-Hakami to write Silm al-Usul ila ilm al-Usul. سألني من لابد من امتثال سؤله الممتثلي. I was commanded to write this book with a person who I could not disagree with him. That's what he says in his kitab, right? He's referring to his Sheikh Abdullah al-Qara'awi. If I go, I'm level to him. This is for me, ulu. Very short chain for me. I passed a person who can not only be my father, but can be my dad's dad. Are you with me, brothers? Now this is something they used to like. The ulus of two types now. There's the ulu called ulu nisbi and ulu mutlaq. Ulu mutlaq is the one that's, the ulu that's between you and the Prophet and is short. It's between you and the Prophet and is very short. The second one is called ulu nisbi. It means nisbi in the sense where to a particular sheikh. And the sheikh gave you an example. Like who? أو إلى إمام ذي شيء صفة علية كشعبة. Like for example, I might have a short chain of narration to شعبة. And that might even be 10 narrators. Does that make sense? But it's to شعبة, I have a very short. It's not to the Prophet, but it's to a particular Imam. It's to a particular Imam. I'll give you an example. And Imam al-Bukhari's shortest hadith, which is called Ulum Mutlaq, is 3. Bukhari has 3 narrations between him and the Prophet. That's the shortest. As for an Imam al-Bukhari, if he narrated from Imam Malik, him to Imam Malik, the shortest chain that Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah has between him and Imam Malik is 9. No, sorry, between him and the Prophet, he has 2 narrations, sorry, before I go to Imam Malik. Between him and the Prophet, Imam al-Bukhari in his Sahih, he has 2 narrations. In some narrations to the Prophet, it's 3. And some narration, the longest he has is 9. Some narrations is 9 between him and the Prophet. 3 is the shortest. The 3 is called Nazil al-Ulu. And the 9 is called Nazil. Look how long he is now. He's become distant from the Prophet. Are you with me? Are you with me, brothers? And the one that he's short is called ulu. That's the lo- so. If somebody asks you today, the hadith of Bukhari, Sahih Bukhari, what's the ulu that Imam Bukhari had? Thulathiyat. Khalas. Ibn Hajar went and he took out all the thulathiyat and he bought it one book. Sah. Second one is the book. The other one is the hadith which are nazil, which Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah narrated it, and that is nazil. Long, it's 9. Now we go back to ulu nisbi. Ulu what? Nisbi. For example, if we look at a sanad of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah between him and Imam Malik, he's got one narrator. That's his ulu. The shortest chain that Imam Malik has towards Imam Malik, sorry, Bukhari has towards Imam Malik is 1. That's the shortest he has. بِنِسْبَةِ إِلَى مَنْ And according to who? Imam Malik is 1. And if he was to narrate it on another narration, he could become 2. So for example, if he goes through Abdullah ibn Yusuf at-Tanisi, it's 1 narrator. Him, he jumps through him to Imam Malik. Or else, he's got 2. And that's his nazil. So to Imam Malik is called ulu what? Ulu nisbi. And to 2 narrators, that's called what? Nuzul nisbi. Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentions Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentions that the ulu and the nuzul, they are nisbiyani. I explained it, right? The ulu nisbi and the nuzul nisbi have four types. And he mentions them. They are al-muwafaqah, and badal, and musawat, and musafaha. Four. Four are ulu and nuzul nisbi. What's the first one? Al-muwafaqah. Second one is badal. Third one is musawat. And the fourth one is musafaha. What does muwafaqa mean? Muwafaqa means when you reach to a shaykh. Ibn Hajar mentioned for you, it means al-wusulu ila shaykhi ahad al-musannifina. When you reach to one of the scholars of hadith, min ghayri tariqihi, without his chain, you reach. It's called muwafaqa. You reach a hadith the same without his chain of narration. For example, Imam al-Bukhari, he says, حَدَّثَنَا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ يُوسُفُ أَخْبَرَنَا مَالِكَ عَنْ أَبِي زِنَادْ عَنِ الْأَعْرَجْ عَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ. Another narrator came. He doesn't use the riwayah, the tariqah of Imam al-Bukhari. Rather, he brings it with another tariqah. And Yusuf, and Abdullah ibn Yusuf. What was the first person who narrated from? And Imam al-Bukhari narrated from who? Abdullah ibn Yusuf. Somebody comes and he narrates it from what? Abdullah ibn Yusuf. What is he in accordance to? So he doesn't go through the tariqah of Imam al-Bukhari. He goes through somebody else. Are you with me? This is called muwafaqah, agreeing with the author. Second is called badal. Badal means you change al-wusul ila shaykhi shaykhihi. It means, I don't even come to Bukhari. I actually start from who? Imam Malik. From the Abdullah ibn Yusuf is the teacher of Imam al-Bukhari. No. I actually go to Imam Malik directly. That's called badal. Al-musawat, it means the number of narrators are equal. The adad is the same. The fourth one is called musafaha. Is that you're equal to the student of the author, Bukhari's student. Like Firyabi, for example, who is a student of Imam al-Bukhari, I become equal to him. That's called al-Rabi'. That's called Musafaha. And the reason why it's called Musafaha is like you shake the hand of Imam al-Bukhari. Just like his student met his teacher, that's what it is. Now the author mentions, I'm going to quickly go over it. Now the author, rahimahullah, he goes into something known as lataif isnadiyah, some powerful benefits of chain you might enjoy. It's lataif isnadiyah. And that is, if a teacher, are you with me? And a student, so if two people, sorry. Aqran means two people share the same teacher. This is called aqran, contemporaries. فَإِنْ تَشَارَكَ الرَّاوِي وَمَنْ رَوَى عَنْهُ فِي السِّنِ وَاللُّقِي. We're the same age, and we also narrated from the same person. We're called aqran, contemporaries. Me and you are contemporaries. We took knowledge from the same person. We can be aqran in age, that can make us aqran. And we can be aqran, even if you're older than me, it doesn't matter. If we took from the same person. I'm your contemporary. So the youngest person here and the oldest person are aqran. They took from one teacher. The second one is called mudabbaj. It now means if the two contemporaries narrate from one another. Two contemporaries are narrating from each other. Like you guys narrating from each other. This is called mudabbaj. Yeah?
وَإِنْ رَوَى عَنْ مَنْ دُونَهُ كَأْفَ الْأَكَابِرِ وَالْأَصَاغِرِ وَمِنْهُ الْآبَاءُ عَنِ الْأَبْنَاءِ وَفِي عَكْسِهِ كَثْرَةٌ وَمِنْهُ مَنْ رَوَى عَنْ أَبِيهِ عَنْ جَدِّهِ.
Now the author mentions رواية الأكابر عن الأصاغر. An elder person narrates from a, that's the third one. An elder person narrates from a person who's young. For example, I now go to you, Yasin, I say, Yasin, hey, faddal, help me here. I'm slightly, I need a narration from you. I was a teacher, I was the kabir here. The kabir here doesn't mean age. It means knowledge. Not that I am more knowledgeable. I narrate from Yasin, he gives me a narration. This is called what? Riwayat al-Akabir ala al-Asaghir. That shows you, my brothers, that elders can't sit and learn from the youngsters. It's not an issue of Kutub al-Hadith, and it's a fun, it's just chapter they talk about. Are you with me? Tirmidhi was happy that Imam al-Bukhari narrated one hadith in his Sahih from him. He'd be happy, it's like, Allahu Akbar, Tirmidhi al-Bukhari narrated from, that's his teacher. And I advise you all to go to the Kitab Fathul Mughith, which is a sharh of Alfiyatu Iraqi. Look at that book, and there's a whole tafsil he goes into Sakhawi regarding the issue of Riwayat al-Akabir anil Asagir. Ah, it happens, it's a lot. Father narrated from his own son, and what falls under that is father narrated from his son, or son narrated from his... This happens, it's very common. And the opposite as well. Riwayat al-Asagir anil Akabir. The youngsters narrated from the elders. That happens. But that one, he didn't mention it here because of what? Oh, he did, he mentioned it, subhanAllah, he did. Asagir, youngsters narrated from the Akabir, the elders. Naam.
وإن اشترك اثنان عن شيخ وتقدم موت أحدهما فهو السابق واللاحق.
For example, the issue of سابق اللاحق means, are you with me, brothers? It means, if I now narrated from Yasin, I was a teacher, pay attention. If I narrated from Yasin, and the youngest of you here narrated from him, let's just say I'm hypothetically I am 50. I definitely am not. Some brothers are looking at me like, yeah, you expose yourself. And I narrated from Yasin, and I die. Some of you guys can live for another 60 years. Does that make sense? So your chain is equal to a teacher's chain.